Well, good evening, good afternoon, good morning, or whatever time of the day it is, wherever you are right now. Welcome to our episode 5, Joel, of Neurodiversity in the World. And I tell you what, it's been one hell of a journey going from, you know, meeting Joel sometime last year to now doing, it feels like we're doing a LinkedIn Live every other day, Joel. And I have no doubt. I have no doubt at all. But it's exciting that we are having this conversation today. And it's I've got lots of questions, and also some interesting thoughts with regards to this topic. But firstly, you know, Joel, do us a favor. Do us a 60-second intro of who you are and where people can find you on LinkedIn, other than right here where we are live right now.
Right, for those of you who are new to this live, and this is the biggest one I've ever done as far as attendance, but my name is Joel, and I am the founder and CEO of RockstarX. let me try that again. I am the founder and CEO of RockstarX. And you can find me normally on my profile or on the RockstarX business page, and just about anywhere online. Google has my entire digital thumbprint, so
it's become a lot wider over the last probably 6 months. It's been incredible. And Joel, I'm glad to be having this conversation with you, because I know when it comes to neurodiversity, it's an interesting subject that I've historically, in my past, have seen a lot of people talk about. Neurodiversity, or, you know, one of the labels that we have within the neurodiverse space, you know, whether it be, you know, myself with dyslexia, or yourself with atypical autism, or apparently I might have ADHD, but I know my daughter has, and, you know, and all those different labels. And I tend to see a lot of the conversations being had by people that are, what do we call them? Atypical. And not necessarily impacted by one of those labels. And today I've got some interesting concepts and thoughts I want to throw out there, after having watched a few interesting TEDx talks by some incredible people that are, you know, not only ADHD but autistic and various other neurodiverse labels. So talk to me about, When it comes to neurodiversity, what is the first thing that comes to your mind?
All our wonderful technology inventions and advances that we use, and a fair number of us take for granted and don't actually marry them up to, they might have been created by a neurodivergent person.
Absolutely. I've just got to throw this in here, because hold on, let me go and show that in there. Manuel Martinez, thank you so much. He's putting there, we are all just shades of colors of light to God, and I'm loving that. Naomi has put the weirdos, or the amazing weirdos. we have so many different labels, but it's the ones that we call ourselves, I guess, at the end of the day, that are some of the best. So talk to me about some of this technology that we forget is designed by some of these incredible human beings.
Well, some of them have not come out publicly and spoken about them. I know there's only one obvious person that has, but that's recently, and only recently, other than that, they are hiding themselves or the ability or their for wanting a better word, label. Whereas I am showing mine here. I'm showing my labels here and here and here. So I'm on one of them right now, Apple. I'm on a Mac right now. And it was never proven, but we can safely assume that Steve Jobs was, besides being one of the greatest inventors of all time, on the spectrum.
Absolutely.
And we can also assume Bill Gates is as well, because when you watch the TED Talk of him in 2015, remember before the pack, when he was predicting now, effectively, and confessing.
Yeah, we've got to be careful where that conversation goes before you get banned from some platform for conspiracy theories.
Yes, but with Bill Gates, notice his eye contact with his TED Talk. He doesn't do that. He doesn't do eye contact.
And this is an interesting thing that you bring up, the eye contact as an example. Because I was listening to a TED Talk by, Jack Den Houting. She's from Australia, did an incredible TED Talk on, and you can go see it on TED Talks and on YouTube. But she only got diagnosed with autism when she was 25. And, there's so many people that some of the statistics that you quoted, that 1 in 50 people have autism. And when you think about that, that's a large number of people. And it's quite interesting that a lot of people, because we are all wired so differently, don't know how to necessarily deal with things, and then see themselves as lesser because they're trying to be or fit, a square peg into a round hole, as an example, as opposed to just being allowed to be themselves and excel at their own, special talents. And that makes it quite frightening, because when we looked at neurodiversity, when you and I first started this conversation, it was frightening how only about 22% of people are actually full-time employed that have, as an example, autism or some form of neurodiverse label. And that's frightening. So, I wanted to kind of get your thoughts on those people that haven't quite figured out the label yet, because they may not have had the resources or the opportunity to go and, find out. What would you say as somebody who is extremely unique when it comes to your thinking, because your sense of humor is a killer. It's awesome. And then obviously you have many other talents like your music and everything else, but what would you, what advice would you give people when it comes to that moment when they're not quite sure how to deal with somebody because the communication style is different? As you say, the programming is different. What advice would you give people on overcoming that kind of bridge or that gap?
Well, Mac, if you are not use Naomi's term here, not of the weird people, then my best advice is to completely ignore what society tells you to believe.
Clear and concise. You see, I'm a rambler, so I'll take like 5 minutes just to pose the question, and then as you can see, Joel just goes and gives me three words and straight to the point. But let me ask you this question: isn't it more suspicious when people aren't weird, Joel?
Is my relationship with people weird?
No. Isn't it more suspicious when people say they aren't weird?
Yes, it is. It is more suspicious, and you can always tell at that point that people are lying. There is no such thing as a non-weird person.
I think this is one of the things that, unfortunately, the world is, due to the way we are programmed and to conform. And then when anything doesn't fit in that box, it's, something's wrong. It's broken. It needs to be fixed. It's, and that's a big challenge when it comes to the communication path. And you put it, previously we spoke about this very, very briefly about, when it comes to wanting to communicate with somebody that is neurodiverse, what is the best way about going about that? Because I love the way you put it previously. I just want to see if we're going to go down that same line again.
Sorry, you were all robotic at that point. My internet must have
dropped out. So my question was, when it comes to communicating with somebody that's different. So as an example, a lot of people have assumptions of what autism is all about. And as we know, that spectrum can be quite broad. And there are different ways that people, show their communication skills. Some people don't speak at all. Some people are very talkative. Some people, as you said, don't make eye contact. What's the best way just to learn? Like if I came up to somebody with autism, what is the best way to approach them that doesn't make it weird or uncomfortable?
That depends on the person. That actually does depend on the person.
Okay. So, one of the things that you mentioned before is, and this is something that, was so, again, so simplistic when it comes to how easy you put things is, when Joel and I first started having conversations, one of the things that you said to me was, instead of sitting there wondering and talking to somebody else about what you think and, asking them questions about, it's like going to somebody with no hair and asking them for hairstyle tips. And I, unfortunately, I'm not going to help you with that situation. I'd rather have the wonderful head of hair that you do, Joel. But, it's the same kind of thing, and you put that in such simple terms of, well, if you want to find out about me and how I function, why don't you just come and ask me? As opposed to going to speak to somebody else and then assume and work out how to communicate and contact, and speak to them. And a lot of the time it's left down to assumption of some people's experiences. And because we programmed so differently, it just comes down to finding out that mutual communication skill. What is the thing that you find, I would say, most frustrating about people that are not necessarily neurodiverse, should we say?
And when people assume, and I've always been told never assume anything. And so if you're driving a car, you don't, well, that's a terrible example. Yes, you do assume, but you don't assume that someone is going to think differently. You assume that everyone's an idiot on the road. And you're for the duration of your car ride, you are an equal idiot, including me. And except I'm an autistic idiot when I'm in that situation.
With no less excuse.
No less excuse, no. And if we are all in the same boat in certain situations, like driving, I'll give you another example as well. And the other example is also with racism. It's we like things to look smart, right? This is a black microphone shield. So if we like things which are black's a color, black's a, it makes things look classy, it makes things look nice. So why do we feel the need to treat other human beings, whatever, autistic or race differently. If we constantly try and find, let's be honest, most of us want to buy a black phone. Yet we can't accept other people.
And it's an interesting one because I, you know, when and like you say, this crosses over into all fields in life, you know, whether it be religion, race, sports, you know, anything that's different. Like I know some footballers who not interested in rugby whatsoever. And I'm like, come on, man. Rugby is a Neanderthal sport with gentlemen in the audience, whereas football is the other way around, where it's like a gentleman sport but chaos in the in the audience, and that's the beauty of, you know, the differences that the world has. And the conversation that I heard Jack Den Houten talking about, when it came to, you know, neurodiversity as a whole, was, you know, about the ability and disability. And I found that quite interesting because the concept around disability, as it were, is, you know, normally disability is something that is assigned to a person, but actually, you know, there's a different way of looking at it, and the whole, you know, looking at disability as somebody being disabled. And, you know, to give you a really ridiculous example, but if you looked at a goldfish and you asked that goldfish to climb a tree, you would say, hey, you know, this goldfish is disabled because its environment isn't, and its abilities aren't, that's not the way it's programmed. You know, it's not made, it's made to swim, not climb a tree. So even if you add a ladder into the mix, you know, the goldfish is still by definition disabled because its environment has disabled it. But you add some water and that goldfish will swim to the top of that tree very quickly. So this is where, you know, understanding where the disability lies. And this is where the, you know, people in that are labeled with neurodiversity, where if we can enable their environments, then we're making that much better for those individuals to be able to communicate and vice versa. And one of the interesting conversations, that, you know, the concept of broken telephone, Joel?
Of a broken record player as well.
Yeah, that's a slight different. Hopefully I don't sound like a broken record player. Repeat myself.
Well, my internet is trying to do a very good job, man.
Yeah, I noticed you kind of unfocused there for a second. I was like, maybe I need my glasses because I've gone a little bit blurry. But it was interesting. You know, Jack spoke about in her TEDx talk about autism. She spoke about a study in Edinburgh where they took three classes of people. They took neurodiverse group. They took the neurotypical group, and then they took a mixture of both, and they basically play, you know, they did that whole broken telephone exercise, and they passed the information as you do through, you know, a group of people. And what they found is the information that came out from the beginning to the end in the neurotypical and the neurodiverse lines, the end message was still almost as clear as the original message. So therefore, there is no, you know, it kind of proved that there was no difference between the two. It's just they programmed differently, so therefore communication is different. But when they mixed the two groups, it massively reduced the outcome because of the difference in communication. And when I listened to that, I was like, yeah, that's really simple. And it's just basic, you know, communication skills. And unfortunately, a lot of the times we don't know the limitations or the communication styles that we need to use, because maybe we ourselves haven't been educated about how we ourselves are wired. And I look at that moment of like when the light bulb went on with my daughter, when we found out, okay, yes, she has ADHD. It's almost like a sigh of relief, like, okay, so I'm not broken. I just work differently and I need, you know, certain things and change my environments likely so I can focus differently and work better. So I guess a question for you, Joel, is when it comes to, you know, your vision for neurodiversity, because there is a massive gap in where it should be and the acceptance and where it is today. So, you know, what are your thoughts on that?
I am wanting to bring the, we've discussed it before, bring inclusion. And the only way I believe that inclusion across the entire world is going to happen is if we change the awareness, we've got enough of that, to acceptance. It seems like society hasn't really got off the fourth stage of grief yet.
Yeah, it's interesting that you put it into that perspective. Carry on. I've got lots of things going through my head. So explain that to people because not everybody understands the four stages of grief.
Well, the first three. I do get mixed up myself.
Give it a shot.
I know they are. I know they are denial. They are anger. They are. Well, denial is number four, actually. Anger is number three. Or is it number one? Anyway, number five is acceptance.
Yeah.
So once you get to acceptance,
depression is the one before.
You're basically there. Ah.
So, and that acceptance side of things is where that's where the magic happens.
Yes. Because then the world opens another door, which no one has noticed before. Even though it's been flashing neon lights for several thousands of years. Eureka.
The light bulb moment.
Yes.
Absolutely. And it's amazing how it's the same, I guess, and if I liken it to sport, because, you know, Or even driving. I think driving is the easiest way of putting it for people that have experienced becoming a learner driver or a driver. Is, you know, you have the four stages of learning. So, you know, you've got that unconscious incompetent stage where you don't know that you don't know, and then you've got that conscious incompetent stage where you kind of go, I know I don't know. Because it's, you know, you're sitting in the passenger seat, you watch somebody else drive, you think, how difficult is this? They're just going like this to the steering wheel, you know? It's like, how hard can that be?
Yeah.
And then you get in behind it and they go, okay, so we want you to hold the steering wheel, then we want you to move the indicator, then you move the gears, and you've got these three pedals, and you've got to move them in a certain sequence. And all of a sudden it's like, what the hell? And then you kind of realize, okay, there's a lot going on here. So it's almost like that swan, you know, serene above the water, but paddling the heck out of it underwater. And then when you go through that next stage of the learning cycle of, okay, I'm now, you know, consciously competent because I'm starting to understand how to communicate with other people and do things differently. Then you go through that learning cycle where eventually you get to the stage and you get to where I've seen some woman drivers where they, unconsciously competent.
Careful, Mac.
And they, no, this is, I find it amazing. You know, where they're driving, they're busy doing their hair and doing their eyeliner and they're driving and not poking their eyes out and, speaking on hands-free and, you know, sorting the kids out in the back seat. And you think, that's a dangerous, risky situation, that whole thing there. And they make it look like it's just something that they do. Not something I would want to go and try.
I wouldn't advocate either.
No, definitely
especially
not.
But what I'm saying, especially if you go down a place where you've got, if you're doing that, and then you see, oh shit, there's a police car.
Well, there's that. But, you know, my point there being is, the more you expose yourself to something, the more you will learn, and the more you learn about it, the easier it gets. And this is one of the big things that I think when it comes to employment in businesses, and acceptance and enablement of environments for people that are neurodiverse, because that's where, you know, different ideas come from, and visions get brought forward, and new discoveries come forward. So, you know, what are your thoughts on that, Joel?
I think that the way to learn, the way to best learn, and I've been saying this for years, including to my teachers and privately, they have actually agreed with me that school teaches absolutely bugger all. The best way of learning is, in fact, doing and making the mistake in the first place. You can read books until the cows come home. You can sit in lessons being told what you're told what to do. But without doing it, you'll never, ever know what you're doing.
And it comes down to those different styles of how people communicate. And yeah, I saw an interesting quote when it comes to neurodiversity about, you know, schooling, as you mentioned, about, you know, when there's one child, as an example, that has ADHD, you know, the whole class, that one child will be taken and told to sit in the corner and behave themselves, because they're upsetting the 27 people in the class, as an example, as opposed to educating the 27 people on how to communicate with that one person. And what you've then taught those 27 people is that anybody that's different, you need to exclude them or put them in a corner because they don't fit in. And that's the reality of the lessons that we're teaching. And that's, you know, frightening when you just change perspective just a little bit.
Yes, it is frightening. And when they put you in the corner because the whole class is complaining, in fact, the class has not actually said a word. The class has not actually said a word. It's been the teacher. So don't give me that old pony about the whole class's benefit. It's yours. It's nothing to do with your class.
So go into a bit more detail there, Joel, because I've got my own thoughts on this, but I suspect you're going in a similar direction.
Well, coming from a family of educators and teachers, you sort of pick up patterns, and especially when you worked at your father's school, you learn more about the students as well. If you're on the janitor side, caretaking side, you're basically in conversation with all the class. You don't see what's behind closed doors, but you've got a general idea. So when a kid misbehaves, I believe it's not because they do it out of spite. It's just that particular lesson or that particular way of teaching is not going to get through to them. And in a classroom, you can't do a tailor-made syllabus on every individual. You'll be there until you're putting your pension out. You'll be trying to plan a lesson, never mind teach. Then the teachers are forced to make decisions based on no one else's mind apart from their own. When the teacher says, I want to put you in a corner because you're disrupting the whole class, that's roughly translating to actual talk, which means you are disrupting my train of thought. Please shut up.
That's extremely... You know, for me, it resonates really loudly because I have the experience of watching one of my children go through exactly that with a teacher who didn't understand neurodiversity at all. And that was exactly the way of responding was, I don't get you. You're annoying me. And that was verbalized quite loudly, but it also resulted in children then following on the bandwagon, thinking, well, it's okay to say that because the teacher thinks that way and says that. Only when we were able to change that environment and put her with a teacher that actually understood how the cogs turn and how she functions, all of a sudden she became the most proactive child in the classroom, where she was enjoying what she was doing. And it all depends on the education, the understanding of that educator, whether they can recognize when somebody needs that extra support, or where the system disables that individual. And I think that's the same as that goldfish analogy. If a goldfish in a tank with no water is not going to thrive, and if you give somebody the right environment, they will thrive. And that's the thing, is finding that environment that works best for each individual.
Yes. And that's what I'm trying to do.
And I'm excited. So if you're watching this and you have faced similar things or know people that have, and you would like to help Joel with, changing the way people are treated and enabling that process, and you've got any ideas or suggestions, please either put those in the comments or reach out to Joel and myself, and let's see how we can make that happen. I'm just looking at through some of the comments here, Joel, and we've got one from Naomi, who's got a question for you. What have you struggled with most in the working world with regards to autism, and how did you solve it? She goes on to say, sometimes I say things that come across blunt or rude, which wasn't her intention, but most autistics get either straight to the point or ramble. There's no in between.
Actually, that question was sadly the end of my career, almost back in 2019, when my cousin had said, right, called me and had texted me when I was on holiday and said, when you get back, we need to talk. And I thought, okay, yeah, fine. I knew what was coming. I knew exactly what was coming. And in no small words, he didn't mince it. He said, you do things differently and you take too long. So we got, there you go. We found someone else.
And that's, I just want people just to kind of listen to that for a second, is, and that happens so often. And I've seen that in corporate workplace, because somebody is different. Instead of finding out, well, hold on, how do we empower that person? How do we find a better way for that person to reach the end goal? It's, well, you don't fit into our system. And I understand that, a lot of businesses, that it's the productivity, it's the conveyor belt process. But the reality is, a lot of the time, the one thing that I love about, people with autism, as Naomi just said, with regards to, you don't, sometimes you don't mince your word. You kind of blunt you straight to the point.
Yeah.
And that's lovely, because it saves a lot of time. But unfortunately, the emotional baggage that we get as we grow up, a lot of people take that quite personally.
It was difficult not to take this personally, because before all that happened in America, when we went to the company, annual meeting, my cousin overstepped the line for his family to boss. And consequently, because he was concerned about what I was eating, because I have, on top of autism, I've got a metabolic condition as well, and I've been dealing with that longer than I know my body better than anyone else does. And he chose at the conference, while we were all having lunch, to yell at me. if I will, if I promise you, if I had anywhere else to go, I would have been out that door and I would have gone. Because he actually said, you either eat properly or you're on the first plane home. And I was eating properly, so I don't know what the hell he was talking about.
But this is the thing,
it's a very, very dangerous game when you're working with family. And this is why.
But I think not only family, just, you know, in any environment where there is any form of, you know, boss or employee or, you know, ranking of any sort, and where you've got, because a lot of the times, you know, people are promoted within organizations because the company, you know, that's a good thing to do. But a lot of the time, and I found this, is not every company invests in education and in management style and communication styles and change management. And therefore, you know, I remember my first opportunity to become a manager. I sucked pretty badly, but I went, you know, I stepped into a managerial role where almost everybody was older than me. And I was, what I'd learned was from a perspective of somebody else I'd watched. And they were never formally trained as management. So their people skills were horrific.
Yeah.
So when I went and said, well, if you don't like it, then get out of here, I thought that was okay to say to people. And clearly it wasn't. I mean, that was just my previous boss's style. But, you know, when it comes to understanding those people around you and being empathetic, sympathetic, but also understanding that, you know, and just to put you in the picture, when Joel talks about his health and diet habits, you know, Joel was on feeding tubes until he was 18, and now has to be on a special diet just to make sure that he survives and stays healthy. So if I didn't know that history and I just assume you're not eating like everybody else, therefore it's wrong, that, you know, as you say, how dangerous that can be when people don't realize the impact of what they're having on that, you know, what might be a minority, one or two people, but the impact for that individual is massive.
LinkedIn user, again, we've got a secret agent in the channel.
Ah, let's have a look.
Only one on that list with a LinkedIn
user, Joel. Okay, so let's have a look. I'm not sure. You can happily put your name into the comments, but it says, Joel, when do you think you should tell your employer that you are neurodiverse? Ooh, we've touched on this very briefly, but Joel, tell us your thoughts, because this is an interesting one.
I've never told.
You've never told?
I've never told.
And what is the reason for that?
Because I know how it would be looked at, and as you say, we've touched on this before, and admitting that you're neurodiverse would get you shown the door.
And this is, you know, a frightening reality. You know, we can't skirt around this. This is a frightening reality where, you know, studies and research have recently shown that a very large percentage, I think it was something like 60-odd% of people in the employee process or the recruiters in an organization would avoid recruiting somebody that is neurodiverse for the fear of not knowing how to deal with it, so therefore just avoid it altogether and rather go for somebody that is, you know, neurotypical. And that is frightening, because that comes down to education again. So we are seeing a lot more people that are running businesses that are autistic and, you know, have ADHD and various other neurodiverse labels, as it were, and very successfully so. Unfortunately, what we're looking at is the majority not understanding how the minority function and how they can add value. So what, you know, with your vision and where you're at now, how do you feel that should be in 5 to 10 years from now, or even in 12 months from now?
Well, my experience is, I now know what not to do as a manager and an owner. Sadly, I wish it was a bit more positive than that. Instead of what not to do, I wish I knew exactly what to do. But all I can say is really in 10 years, I want to look society or the good law straight in the eye and say I've done it my way.
I love that. Absolutely. And that, you know, each one of us should be in that position where we're able to say, you know, this is me, this is who I am, this is how I show up. And, you know, even having to question, you know, that whole statement that we have over there, you know, when do you think you should tell your employer? You know, in the bigger scheme of things, we should be in a world where that shouldn't matter. But at the same time, when we talk about disability and enablement, unfortunately, we're in a world where, you know, neurodiversity is a minority. And this is where I'm kind of two minds with this, where I know that we shouldn't be necessarily, it shouldn't matter. But at the same time, it has to matter, because you have to be able to enable the employer or the environment to make it, a more productive environment for that individual, so that they can blossom and prosper as well. So our environments are the disability in a lot of cases.
Yes. And I also think that I'm going to drop another bomb here, Mac.
Thanks.
Our own self is also a disability. So we are our own, if you like, blockade. And to we can't really go from awareness to acceptance until we remove the real obstacle, which is ourselves.
The belief system. It's an interesting thing, because that's something that let me put it this way. There's a whole, you know, billion-dollar business built on that concept. And it's called life coaches. You know, how many life coaches are out there trying to help people overcome their own set of restrictions and limiting beliefs, as we call them? And the frustrating thing is, I think a lot of the limiting beliefs are, you know, just imagine how that goldfish feels because he can't climb a tree, you know? Absolutely horrible. The mouth movement there, you know, but why the hell should a goldfish feel inadequate because it can't climb a tree? And this is the part that really works on my nerves when it comes to, you know, people who don't accept different because they like what's the same as them. But then, you know, the whole world would just be such a boring place, because it would just be so easy to predict. And, you know, none of the magic would happen, because there'd be no surprise, and you'd wake up every day and there'd be no happiness or sadness, because there's nothing, you know, of substance. So I think that embracing, and it's scary that we are having a discussion around the fact that people have to even wonder about, do they tell their employee, don't they, do they come out, don't they? You know, it comes back to, you know, the same thing with regards to, you know, I come from South Africa as an example, and being able to, you know, in as we went through apartheid, you know, there were certain people who didn't, you know, they wanted to be, you know, they had to choose what color they wanted to associate with, just in case they were treated differently. And that is just, you know, the fact that it's so barbaric. And whether it, you know, comes to our sexual orientation or our religious convictions, or, you know, the color of the clothes that we wear, You know, if you go into Camden and you've never been to Camden here in the UK, by the way, and you just come from a very kind of laid back, you know, suburban area anywhere in the world, you are going to, you know, walk around with your jaw on the floor going, holy cow, what have I just walked into? You know, and you're going to see people with, you know, more metal in their face than anything else. But that's okay. That's their choice. And people with mohawks and all the, but these people that are willing to express themselves and just be, and that's what just makes your life so exciting about the individuals that we have. So, Joel, what are your thoughts? I mean, if the world was standard neurotypical,
it is neurotypical.
No, but if it is just neurotypical, there's no neurodiverse. How, like, imagine how, what's the word? Beige, I guess the world would be just like boring, only one flavor of ice cream, you know, vanilla. Yeah. That's it.
I don't know whether you can, I don't know whether you can hear this, but the sound, like this sound sums it up perfectly.
Oh, absolutely love it. Joel, I'm conscious that we've also gone over time, and I love these conversations with you and learning about, you know, your thoughts around this. And, yeah. You know, I just want to, you know, tell people that, you know, I've experienced, and I have a lot of friends and family that are in the neurodiverse, you know, somewhere in on one of the labels. And they are the best people I've, you know, without them, my life would be, like, it probably wouldn't be worth living. You know, I want to thank you for having the courage, Joel, because it's one of the big things when it comes to not only neurodiversity, because you were talking about, you know, the belief systems and our limiting beliefs, as it were, but, you know, there are courses and millions of dollars that get spent on just stage fright, you know, overcoming the fear of speaking in front of people. And you know, that could be a whole category on its own. You know, we can start calling them something weird. And you know, I used to literally want to throw up before I spoke publicly anyway. Now it's getting a little bit easier, but I'm still hiding behind a screen.
Maybe that's so, because you're picturing everyone naked then.
No, you'd see a very weird look on my face if I was. but you know, this is the thing, is that each one of us have something that we fear to overcome. And, you know, I look at with the first conversations we had, you know, the first interview we did was, you know, I wasn't sure what to expect, where we were going to go. And I didn't want my preconceived experience to judge that. And this is one of the things that I'd suggest to other people out there, is that when you go and meet somebody new, meet somebody different, find out what is that part that really makes them different. What makes them tick? You know, if it's somebody from a different culture, find out what kind of food they eat, you know, go and burn yourself on a hot chili just so that you can say you lived. I won't do it again. I've tried. But go and experience different things, you know, different cultures, different languages, different colors, different religions, so that we can become a lot more accepting of each other and know that it's okay to be different.
Yes, indeed. I've added some more stuff to that playlist as well, Mac, which I do encourage people to go and listen to, as do you. Just put that in the comments there.
Awesome stuff.
And yes, the next one is on the 30th, so
awesome stuff. Well, I'm looking forward to having that conversation. We've gone a few minutes over, as every time, Joel. But
I told you, Mac, don't put yourself on a time limit, because you may have too much. You may be having too much fun, and you don't want to constrict yourself.
No, well, that's no, definitely not. I'm not going to go off on a tangent on that comment. But listen, I want to thank everybody who's watched this far, and for taking the time. You know, Joel, keep doing the great things that you're doing, keep working on RockstarX, and I look forward to seeing the amazing things that are to come.
So do I, Mac. So do I.
Excellent stuff. Can you do our outro for us, or your sting, yes, if you can?
Which one would you like?
your answer.